A little over 2 years ago, I spoke on the same subject that I intend to use this morning. I've entitled our thoughts, "The Gospel of Salvation and Service According to a Penny." A little penny. And if you're ever trying to witness someone and don't have a Bible at hand, you can take what I'm going to be saying this morning and use a penny as you witness for the Lord. If you got a penny, we'll look at it a moment there. I've got some extra ones if you need one. Okay, we want to read the scriptures in Mark in the beginning. Mark chapter 12, verse 13. "And they sent unto him," or Jesus, "certain of the Pharisees and of the Herodians, to catch him in his words. When they were come, they say unto him, Master, we know that thou art true, carest for no man, for thou regardest not the person of men, but teachest the way of God in truth. Is it lawful to give tribute to Caesar or not? Shall we give or shall we not give? But Jesus, knowing their hypocrisy, said unto them, Why tempt ye me? Bring me a penny that I may see it." Now, they didn't have a penny, American penny, in those days, but it was a penny. But the Pharisees sought to accuse Christ here, as they did many times. It says they tried to catch him in his words. So he asked them for a penny. But I've got a question on y'all. This week I stopped somewhere, and there was a shiny penny there, and I picked the penny up. Now, I want to ask an honest confession. How many of y'all stop and pick up a penny? All right, almost everyone. Now, some of us senior citizens can remember when you could buy something with a penny, particularly they had a little package of kits. And y'all remember the kits, the candy little square things? At four in a package for one penny. Can you believe that? That's a long time ago, isn't it? By the way, a lot of people lose pennies, a lot of men especially, by reaching in their pockets and pulling out car keys and so forth. Well, I stopped that some few years ago. Instead of pulling out my car, I carry a purse. Not many guys carry a purse, but I carry a pair of scissors in there and a razor box cutter. And then I carry a pocket full of change. And that way, when you reach in your pocket, you don't lose your change by trying to pull out something else, your car keys particularly. But a penny doesn't mean much money-wise nowadays. Matter of fact, you go into some stores where you check out, and they'll have a little bowl of pennies. They'll take one if you need it, or if I mean you need to do transaction here. Y'all seen places like that, but just reach in there and they'll give you a penny. In other words, a penny is not worth much. It's base, would you not say? And if you would, that brings me to the next verse of Scripture, 1 Corinthians 1, 27 through 28. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty, and base things of the world, things which are despised, hath God chosen, yea, things which are not, to bring to naught things that are. So the Bible says plainly here that God hath chosen the base things of the earth. Would you not say a penny would qualify for being base? I think so. By the way, I saw, before I prepared the message for today, I saw an article on a penny this week on the internet where sometime back there was one that sold for $1.7 million. Y'all can tell me what year that penny was made, can't you? He got his finger up. 1943, right in the middle of World War II, they thought to conserve copper, so they quit striking coins right quick. But they said a few got by. By the way, if you find a 43 penny, most of them are silver color. They're lead looking. They're made out of lead. But because of the need of copper and ammunition and what have you for the World War II, they quit making the copper pennies for that year. However, there was a handful that got minted, and one of those pennies sold recently for $1.7 million. But Jesus here asked for a penny. He knew how to present truth where people could understand it. Many times we as speakers or pastors or preachers of the word, we assume that everybody's on the same level spiritually, where the Bible says some of those people are in need of milk. They can't take meat. And we have to feed them, don't we, with milk. And basically that's what we're doing this morning. It's going back to plain, simple message taken from a penny. The message of salvation. Is on the penny. If you will look at your penny, if you have one, the face of a penny. Mine says 1993. So just hold on to yours a moment. But it's a message of salvation. Number one, I saw a big article in the Houston Chronicle this morning where they're trying to bring back the saying, and there's a huge whole page of a chronicle there that says, "In God we trust." They're trying to have that put back into the schools and so forth. And I've seen some police cars in some places today where they have that written on the car. In God we trust. Not man. Simple truth is, according to the scripture, man can't be trusted, can he? Cursed is man that trusts in man, but blessed is a man whose trust is in God. Salvation is by trust or by faith, is it not? In God we trust. If you will, look at your paper in the middle of the page here, Acts 16, verse 31. And they said, Paul and Silas said to the jailer, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house." believe me, to trust in, to lay your life on the line with him. And then Acts 4 and 12 says, if you will, back to the middle of your page, neither is our salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Plain and simple truth, there is no other way than through him. Somebody says, well, oh, I believe there's a God. And y'all have heard me say this before, because the scripture says, the devils likewise believe, and they tremble. But if you will look again at your scripture, John 5, verse 24. Verily, verily, I say unto you, I want y'all to soak this in now. He that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me is going to have everlasting life. Now, wait a minute. Not what it says, is it? He that believeth on me hath everlasting life. You don't have to wait to get it, folk. If you put your trust in him, it's there.
Right.
And shall not condemn into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life.
Amen.
That's final, isn't it? Old Brother Kirkland in seminary used to say, fella, you couldn't go to hell if you wanted to, because you've been born into the family of God.
Right.
And God does not disown his children. Although we probably make him want to sometimes. In God we trust, and the Lord said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. At liberty. If you will, if you look at your penny, what does it say on this? At liberty. Okay. Does your penny say penny to the left or on the face? It says liberty, does it not? Liberty means free. And Jesus said, if I make you free, you shall be free indeed. Free from what? Free from sin and death. The Lord said, whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Romans 8, verse 2, if you will, look at your paper. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. And if you will, look on down to the next verse, Romans 8, 21. Because the creature, the body itself, also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. So you trust in God, you're given liberty, right? Now, if you will, look at your next verse of scripture, Romans 4, and we look at the face of the penny, and whose inscription or whose picture is that supposed to be? Abraham Lincoln, right? Where he got his namesake was Father Abraham in the Bible. And let's see what it says about Abraham that believed God. Romans 4, verse 1. What shall we say then that Abraham, our father, as pertaining to the flesh, hath found? For if Abraham were justified by works, He that he hath whereof to glory, but not before God. For what saith the scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. It's believing God, isn't it? Abraham was saved because he trusted God, not because of his works. Realize, Abraham wasn't perfect. We can read in the scripture, we can find where he let the Lord down. When, especially his beautiful wife, and he thought the king might want her for his own. So he told his wife, we're going to lie about who you are. We're not going to tell that guy you're my wife because he might kill me to take you. This is Abraham we're talking about. But Abraham, just like you and I, he was imperfect, was he not? But he believed God. He was saved because he trusted God. Folks, you're not going to be saved because you've been a pretty good person. Doesn't work that way. You're saved because of what you do with Christ. But if you will, the penny that I have now says 2006. 2006, where'd that come from? 2006 years ago, our Lord Jesus Christ came into the world in the form of a man. He was always here. But he came, he took upon himself the form of a man, was born of the Virgin Mary. And we put our trust in that fact of what happened 2006 years ago, that a Savior truly was born, and we trust in him because of what he did 2006 years ago. If you would, notice that the coin is made in the form of a circle, which has no end. It's a picture of eternity. When you put your trust in Christ and you're made at liberty, you're saved because you believe in what happened 2006 years ago. You're saved for 2006, for time, and the circle, for time and eternity. Let's say that again. You're saved for time and eternity. Well, folks, when we pass this realm of life into the other side, you can throw your clocks away because they represent time. But then you'll be in an eternal state. You get to live forever with him. So the front side of the coin is all about salvation. But then you flip that coin over, and it's about service. United States of America. We are united today as a body or as a church. We're here at the church to serve the Lord, to carry on his business, because he gave his business to us, did he not? Mine says E Pluribus Unum on it. Y'all ever see that statement? What's that mean? It means one of many. And as our church is one of many today, you and I individually are one of many. We're servants out of many, to many. And folks, we're obligated unto service. We're obligated to serve Him. And right at the bottom of the penny I have, yours, sometimes they change the back quicker than they change the front. But mine says 1 cent. Some years back, I looked that up because I'd used this message already. And the word cent, C-E-N-T, means the same thing as S-E-N-T. 1 cent. And I tell you this morning that every Christian is sent into the world. The Lord said to His that He would send us forth as sheep among wolves. Shall I say that again? The Lord said He would send us forth as sheep among wolves. And folks, the devil's out there. He doesn't like for people to be saved. He's doing as much turmoil as he can because the scripture says he knows he had but a short season. Just turn on the news and see what he's doing to people's lives. And we tolerate it. But in the, if you will look back at your paper, Psalms 126, verse 6. He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. He that goeth forth and weepeth, that means you've got to be concerned for people. You've got to have a burden for them, for lost souls. And the Lord gave us a promise that we'll doubtless come again if we go in the right spirit, bringing the sheaves with us. Oh, the Lord expects a life of service. He Himself was a servant, obedient unto death. For you and I. He came to serve, not to be served. And I'd say to you today, the Lord expects it. And He asks the question, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? Well, that means something is critical, something is vital, something we can't afford to overlook. Our soul winners go forth. And they go out to tell people about Jesus. Well, I can tell you this much. Most people don't want to hear about Jesus. Most of them don't want you bothering them while they're watching a football game or a baseball game on Sunday afternoon. Come and put up signs. They don't want folks bothering them. But I can tell you this much, folks. When all's said and done, when you're in eternal ages, somebody's going to be praising you for taking time to tell them about Jesus. The Lord made us servants unto Him. And again, let me quote that scripture. It says, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? Okay, people that are headed to eternity to be forever separated from God unless they come to Christ. There's no way you and I can address eternity. It's something that has no end. You know, the Jehovah's Witness like to go around and tell people there's no hell. That's one of their favorite things. There's no hell. But I can tell you they're far wrong. Even if you followed what they tried to tell you, that when you're dead, you're dead. Question. Do you want to be dead forever when God intended for you to enjoy life forever? If you're dead forever, that's hell, isn't it? Because you're going to be separated from God, the one that loved you and made you in his own image. And folk, that's hell. But think forever separated from God. Without the fire, that's still hell. But I can tell you this much. The rich man, Luke 16, had been in hell at least 2,000 years and he just got started. There is no end. But you know the sad part of it all? That's not what our Lord intended. If he intended that, he would not have gone to the cross and paid the price that you and I, unworthy sinners, could not pay. He did it for us. And then finally, if you will, look at that last verse of Scripture. And this is about service still. Ephesians 6, verse 16. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And folk, when we go forth, we need to go in faith. And folk, it's not blind faith, because God promised he'd be with us if we go in his name. And if you can't go with the soul winners, pray for them, that the Lord will lead them to the place where he'd have them be. And give them the word to say that would cause people to stop, listen, and take action. Folk, it's simple. You take that little penny, very little basic thing that people don't pay much mind. As a matter of fact, I had to go back and read it. And yet there's so much truth gleaned from a little copper penny. It tells us if we put our trust in God, what God did for us, we can be saved.